أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله لا إله إلا الله
بسم الله. الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، إنه من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله عز وجل، وأحسن الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وما قل وكفى خير مما كثر وألهى. وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. ثم أما بعد, all praise is due to Allah, we praise Him, and we seek His aid and forgiveness, and we seek refuge in Allah from the evils of ourselves and bad deeds. Whomsoever Allah guides, no one can mislead, and whomsoever Allah lead astray, there is no guidance for him. I bear witness and testify that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his last messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. O you who have believed, fear Allah as he ought to be feared, and die not except in a state of Islam. O mankind, be dutiful to your Lord, who created you from a single soul, and created from it its mate, and scattered from both many men and women. And fear Allah, to whom you demand your mutual rights, and have a good kinship relations. Indeed, Allah is always watching over you. O you who have believed, fear Allah and speak always the truth. He will fix your deeds and forgive you your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger will achieve a great success. Indeed, the most truthful book is the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the best guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst matter is the innovation in the deen. And every innovation in the deen is misguidance. And every misguidance will be in the hellfire. And to proceed, my brothers and sisters in Islam, today may be the final day of the Islamic year. Or maybe tomorrow, according to the moon sighting. And at the end of every year, we must hold ourselves accountable for everything we did in this year. This year is a file. This file will be sent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will not be able to bring it back. Whatever we did in this year is recorded. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran is instructing us to hold ourselves accountable, to take complete responsibility for our actions and deeds and decisions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala offered us seasons of worship to take advantage of. He multiplied His reward and offered His mercy and forgiveness in these seasons of worship. So there are people who took advantage of these seasons of worship, and there are people who were heedless. So it is important at the end of the year, the way you do in your life, at the end of every year, you sit down to see in your business if you made profit or if you have loss, to pay your taxes, to plan for the next year to be better than the previous year. It is very important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Hashr, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَبِيرٌ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. All you have believed, look to what you did in the previous year. Fear Allah. All you have believed, fear Allah. وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ. Every soul must look. What did you do for tomorrow? What did you prepare for your coming life, for your next life? What did you do? Look, hold yourself accountable. Allah is all acquainted of what we are doing, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows what we are doing, azza wa jal. He said, وَلَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنفُسَهُمْ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَاسِقُونَ. Don't be like those who are heedless. They are forgetting about Allah, so Allah will make them forget themselves. The repayment always from the same nature of our actions. If we will forget about Allah, Allah will make us forget ourselves. We will forget our purpose of existence. We will be heedless of our life and what benefits us. If we are heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you are forgetting about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the repayment will be from the nature of our actions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is telling us to sit with ourselves, to reflect, to think, to see what did we do for our future, for after death. You know, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swore after he negated our wrong thoughts. He said, La. La. He started Surah Al-Qiyamah by saying, La. No, it is not the way you think. No, it is not the way you think. You are in complete delusion. And he swore upon that. He said, أُقْسِمُ بِيَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ. It is not the way you think. Allah is swearing by the day of judgment, the day of resurrection, the day when He will help, when He will hold us accountable for our deeds, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he said, Wala. He's saying, No again. Nay. It is not the way you think. أُقْسِمُ بِالنَّفْسِ اللَّوَّامَةِ. I swear by the reproaching soul. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by the reproaching soul, the soul that blame itself. Why Allah is swearing? You're always hearing from us that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is swearing by something, He wants to bring our attention to the importance of what He is swearing by subhanahu wa ta'ala. So He is swearing by the reproaching soul. النفس اللوامة. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala want us to blame ourselves in this dunya before it's too late. Before it's too late, we have been offered the month of Ramadan. We have been offered the night of Laylatul Qadr. Who took advantage of this valuable time? We have been offered the season of Hajj and Umrah. We have been offered the first 10 days of the Hijjah, the reward of the day of Arafah, of fasting the day of Arafah, slaughtering in the day of Eid. Who took advantage of that? And who just was reckless, neglecting what he was created for, thinking only about the dunya? It is important to sit with yourself, to hold yourself accountable. Umar radiallahu anhu in his khutbah used to say to the Muslims, حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا وزنوا أعمالكم قبل أن توزنوا وتزينوا ليوم العرض الأكبر يومئذ تعرضون لا تخفى منكم خافية. So Umar used to say, radiallahu anhu, in his speech, حاسبوا أنفسكم قبل أن تحاسبوا. Hold yourself accountable before you are held accountable for what you did. زنوا أعمالكم قبل أن توزنوا. It means put your deeds in your own scale before Allah puts it in His scale. Evaluate yourself before you are evaluated. And get ready for the day that you will be exposed by your deeds before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the creation. Then he recited, يَوْمَ إِذٍ تُعْرَضُونَ لَتَخْفَ مِنْكُمْ خَافِيَةً. In this day, all your deeds will be exposed. Nothing will be hidden. Nothing will be hidden. So none of us will be able to hide anything he did and did not repent from. If we did something and we did not repent from, out of arrogance, out of heedlessness, it will be exposed in the day of judgment in front of Allah and in front of the creation. Maymun ibn Mahran used to say, لا يكون العبد تقيا حتى يحاسب نفسه محاسبة الشريك الشحيح لشريكه. You should not consider yourself a pious person or righteous person until you treat yourself like a cheap partner. Imagine yourself when you have a partner in business and your partner is cheap. He will sit with you to discuss every dime. He will never let penny to go away. He will ask you for every detailed thing. So Maymun ibn Mahran is saying, none of us deserve to be called a pious person or a righteous person until he sits with himself like a cheap partner to ask himself about every small thing. Every small thing. You must believe in the 6 articles of faith. You must know your creed, your aqidah. You must perform your prayers the way Allah wants, the way Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught you. You must fast in the month of Ramadan, pay your zakah on time, go to Hajj at least once in your lifetime. You need to be good to your kin. You need to be good to your neighbors. You need to obey Allah in every order He commanded in the Quran. You must obey Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in everything he legislated in his sunnah. Are we doing that? If we are not doing that, when we will wake up? The only way to wake up is to sit down with ourselves and to ask ourselves. Ask yourself, how about my relationship with my parents? How about my relationship with my brothers and sisters and aunts and uncles and cousins? How about my relationship with my wife and kids? How about my relationships with my Muslim brothers? There are rights Allah will ask us about. And if we don't sit down to judge ourselves in details, we will suffer the sorrow when Allah Azza wa Jal judges us in the day of judgment. Subhanallah, we all knew that the most righteous person after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. No one is better than Abu Bakr. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if we will put Abu Bakr in a pan of a scale and we will put the entire Ummah of Islam from the time of the companions until the day of judgment, Abu Bakr is heavier. Abu Bakr is righteous. If there will be a prophet after Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so Abu Bakr is the only worthy person to be. And also Umar radiallahu anhu. This Abu Bakr, when Umar entered his house to visit him, Umar found Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu grabbing his tongue out of his mouth. Grabbing his tongue out of his mouth. So Umar radiallahu anhu told him, "Mah, ghafar Allahu laka Abu Bakr. May Allah forgive you, Abu Bakr. Look what you are doing. Why you grab your tongue out of your mouth?" He said, "Hadha alladhi awradani sharra al-mawarid. This tongue will take me to the worst place. This tongue will take me to hellfire. This tongue will destroy me. This tongue, the tongue of who? The tongue of whom? The tongue of the most righteous person after Prophet Muhammad alayhi wasalam in the history of Islam. The tongue of the one who is called As-Siddiq, the most truthful. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is the most truthful person after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Sadiq alayhi sallatu wassalam, Sadiq al-Amin. Our Prophet alayhi sallatu wassalam is Sadiq al-Amin, the truthful, the trustworthy. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was labeled with this title, As-Siddiq. Why? Because he believed in every truth. And he speaks always the truth. And this man who is speaking always the truth, and the entire ummah, including Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is testifying for him and for his truthfulness. He is grabbing his tongue out of his mouth and saying that this tongue is taking me or leading me to be in the worst place. See how he is criticizing himself. He's not seeing any positive thing in what he is doing. Out of humbleness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we speak, mashallah, like a talking machine. Day and night. Because we don't pay taxes for what we say. It's a free. It's a free always to speak. So people, when they speak, sometimes they speak out of ignorance. They speak about what they don't know. Even when they say this is halal and this is haram, sometimes it's out of desire. They may curse, they may backbite, they may gossip, they may spread rumors. And they are not seeing themselves doing anything bad. And if somebody is reminding them, they will show arrogance and fight him back. And fight him back. While the companions radiallahu anhum used to criticize themselves out of humbleness. With this righteous record and great record, you know, Umar radiallahu anhu, al-Faruq, he was called al-Faruq because in his decisions, in his talk and in his walk, he knew how to distinguish between right and wrong, halal and haram, good and evil. Prophet Muhammad said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if Umar walked in a street, the shaitan will never walk in it. The Prophet said alayhi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the shaitan is always afraid of Umar. If Umar in a place, the shaitan will never be in it. You just reflect on that. And the Prophet also said in clear statement, لو كان بعدي نبي لكان عمر. If there will be a prophet after me, and the fact there is no prophet after Muhammad alayhi wasallam, but the Prophet said, if there will be a prophet after me, Umar will be. He has the qualities. He has the qualities. And Umar radiallahu anhu, in his death time, when he was stabbed while he is leading the salah, he was stabbed while he is doing a righteous action, leading the salah of the Muslims, Salat al-Fajr. And the kafir came and stabbed him. So his son, Abdullah ibn Umar, took his head on his lap, took the head of his father Umar, he was bleeding, to his lap. Then Umar radiallahu anhu told him, put my cheek on the dust, la umma lak. He spoke to him in a very aggressive way, the way they speak in the past. He said to him, La umma lak, put my cheek on the dust. La'alla Allah yarhamuni. Put my cheek on the dust, so may Allah have mercy on me. He is the president of the United States of Islam. The man who lived with the qualities of Prophet, the man who is by the testimony of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, al-Faruq, the one who used to scare the shaitan, the one that Allah opened countries and villages to Islam in his leadership, in the time of his leadership. He still seeing himself nothing, calling his son to put his cheek on the dust out of humbleness. And he kept saying, Ya layta umma Umar lam talid Umar. He was wishing that his mother never gave birth to him. He doesn't want to be a created being. He wished that he never existed after all of what he did. Righteous actions, but see how he sees himself and how we see ourselves. So at the end of the Islamic year, we need to sit down with ourselves and to ask. And by the way, the righteous believer always hold himself accountable before the action and after the action. Before you, the action, you ask yourself why you are doing it. You ask yourself how you will do it in a legitimate way to be accepted. How to protect what you did to be accepted. You need to think, and after you maintain doing the action of worship the way Prophet Muhammad taught you alayhi salatu wassalam, you need to think after you finished how you did it. If something went wrong, to fix it and to correct it. Without that, it's not gonna be good in the day of judgment. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه سميع قريب مجيب. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد البشير النذير السراج المنير، وسلم اللهم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، أيها المسلمون عباد الله، we need to care about the acceptance of Allah to our deeds and actions. Not only to care until we do the deed, we must care after we finish the deed about the acceptance of the deed. The companions of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wassalam used to care about the acceptance of the deed more than their caring about the deed itself. Because think about it, if you do a lot of deeds, you made Hajj 50 times, you went to Umrah 100 times, you spent millions of dollars, how about if Allah did not accept from you? How about why we are taking the acceptance for granted? The companions never felt this feeling. They never took the acceptance of Allah for granted. They humbled themselves before the action of worship, during the action of worship, after the action of worship. They keep begging Allah to accept from them. And we all heard multiple times around Ramadan about the companions. After Ramadan, they keep asking Allah Azza wa Jal for 6 months to accept from them. Because the acceptance is not guaranteed. And if somebody was fasting every day in Ramadan and praying the Taraweeh prayer every night and reciting the Quran and donating money and trying his best to invest the night of Al-Qadr to the best of his ability, if Allah did not accept from him, it means nothing. So it is very important to care about the acceptance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah said that in the Quran. There is a hadith, and this hadith is reported in Sunan al-Imam al-Tirmidhi and narrated by the mother of the believers radiallahu anha, Aisha radiallahu anha. She said Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reciting الَّذِينَ يُؤْتُونَ مَا آتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَهُ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. So Allah here is talking about people, they did their deeds while their hearts are fearful that they will be returned back to Allah. They will have meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So why their hearts are fearful? Aisha radiallahu anha raised the question and said, O Messenger of Allah, هَلْ هُمْ الَّذِينَ يَشْرَبُونَ الْخَمْرَ وَيَسْرِقُونَ. Are they the people who drink alcohol and steal? They did these bad actions while their hearts are fearful? The Prophet said, no. لَا يَبْنَةَ الصِّدِّيقِ. No, O daughter of a Siddiq. These people are those who fasted. He said, الَّذِينَ يَصُومُونَ وَيُصَلُّونَ وَيَتَصَدَّقُونَ يَعْنِ يَدْفَعُونَ الزَّكَاةِ. These people are those who fast. They're fasting. They're mandatory fasting. Those who pray the 5 daily prayers. Those who pay their zakah while their hearts are fearful. Why? Why they are afraid while they are worshipping? They are afraid their deeds will not be accepted. They care about the acceptance. They care about the acceptance. You know, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the names of the hypocrites to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and commanded him to keep it secret, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam trusted Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, and he told Hudhayfa the names of the hypocrites and told him not to share these names. And Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu found Umar radiallahu anhu coming to say, Nashattuka Allah, I'm asking you by Allah, I swear upon you by the name of Allah, did you hear my name among the names of the hypocrites? Imagine Umar radiallahu anhu. Umar, the Prophet is saying alayhi salatu wasalam, if there will be a prophet, Umar will be the one. And Umar is afraid that his name is one of the names of the hypocrites. See to which level he is humble. He's down to earth. He sees himself doing nothing. So Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman said, no, O Umar, your name is not in this list, and I will never answer this question to anyone else. Because the Prophet said that. But Umar, because Umar is one of the people of Jannah, Umar already was told that he is one of the people of Jannah. But see to which level. Yani Umar radiallahu anhu came one day to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari was standing beside the door as a doorman. So when Umar came to visit the Prophet, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari said, wait until I seek permission from Prophet Muhammad alayhi wa sallam. So when Abu Musa entered and said, O Messenger of Allah, Umar at the door, seeking permission to enter. So the Prophet told him, allow him to enter and tell him the good news that he is one of the people of Jannah. Aidan lahu bil-dukhul wa bashirhu bil-jannah. So Umar radiallahu anhu heard the glad tiding and the good news from the mouth of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he is one of the people of Jannah, and he still doubting himself. Aisha radiallahu anha, wallahi al-azim, when you hear this about Aisha radiallahu anha, when she suffer headache, and also it is said by Asma, it is said by Abu Darda radiallahu anhu, when they get headache, they say, بِذَنْبِي وَمَا يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ أَكْثَرُ. يعني, this headache is because of my sin, and what Allah forgives is more. Allah forgives a lot. Who amongst us, when something bad happened to him, he says, it is because of my sin? Who amongst us, when he loses money, when he is oppressed by an oppressor, when he just survived a car accident, he say, it happened because of my bad deeds? Think about it. This is the way of the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They used to blame themselves. Anything bad happened to them, they blame themselves. They don't blame anyone else. They blame only themselves. So this is something that we need to think of. When the companions went to the battlefield in the day of Badr, small amount of Muslims, third of their enemies in power, the amount of Muslim soldiers were third of the soldiers of the enemies. But this group of Muslims have no hypocrite amongst them. All of them, by the testimony of the Prophet alayhi wasalam, by the testimony of the Quran, righteous people. That's why Allah granted them victory. In the day of Uhud, when some Muslims disobeyed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that caused a defeat after victory. The Muslims were victorious in the beginning, But this, their victory ended with the killing of 70 Muslims, 70 Muslim leaders. And it is considered the defeat. And they went with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Hamra al-Asad, whispering in the ear of each other. Why? Why we lost? We won in Badr, even in Uhud. We won in the beginning. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is with us. How we lost? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered them and said, أولما أصابتكم مصيبة قد أصبتم مثليها قلتم أن هذا قل هو من عند أنفسكم. Now you are complaining because you lost 70 in the day of Badr, in the time of your obedience. You killed the 70 of the leaders of the idol worshippers and captured another 70. 70 got killed and 70 got captured. Now because of your sin, you lost the 70. And you come in to complain, complain about yourself. Allah said, قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِكُمْ. It came from you. You caused it to happen. So this is the statement that every Muslim must say to himself. I caused it to happen. If something bad happened to you, don't blame no human being except yourself. And you heard me multiple times to tell you that Adam alayhi salam, when he committed a sin and disobeyed Allah, he never complained about anybody except himself. His wife Hawa, same thing. She never complained about anybody except herself. If you see the history of the righteous people that Allah spoke about in the Quran, all of them, if one of them committed a sin, he blames himself. He blames himself. And work to fix the problem, to apologize, to humble himself to his Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very important. It is very important. You know, the first crime happened on earth. What is the first crime happened after Adam and Hawa came down to earth? One of the sons of Adam killed the other. Why? Because both of them, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِذْ قَرَّبَا قُرْبَانًا فَتُقُبِّلَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمَا وَلَمْ يُتَقَبَّلْ مِنَ الْآخَرِ قَالَ لَأَقْتُلَنَّكَ قَالَ إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. So both Qabil and Habil, they donated something for the sake of Allah. One of them chose the best of what he has and donated the best money he has. And the other one, he chose what he doesn't need, some garbage stuff that he doesn't need, and donated the garbage. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the donation of Habil, did not accept the donation of Qabil. And he saw the sign of the acceptance by their eyes. In this era, people used to see the sign of the acceptance of Allah. If they did something, they see if Allah accepted it or not in their lifetime. So the one who lost the acceptance, instead of blaming himself, instead of learning his lesson, he went to the accepted person to tell him, I will kill you. So Habil told him, إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah accepts from those who are righteous. Allah accepts from those who are pious. Those who do their best to please their Lord, not those who are arrogant, keeping everything for their dunya, and then just they give garbage for akhirah, what they don't need, what is extra. So this is the difference. إِنَّمَا يَتَقَبَّلُ اللَّهُ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. Read the Quran. You will find that Ibrahim alayhi salam and his son Ismail, after they finished raising the pillars of Al-Kaaba, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلُ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. So they finished raising the pillars of Al-Kaaba, and the first thing they were busy with, Oh Allah, accept from us. It is very important. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said in his dua, رَبِّ اجْعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاء. Oh Allah, make me among those who perform their prayers, establish their prayers, and my offspring. Guide my offspring to do same thing. Oh Allah, accept my dua. Oh Allah, accept my dua. It is very important. Imratu Imran, إذ قالت Imratu Imran, رب إني نظرت لك ما في بطني محررا فتقبل مني. So the mother of Maryam, she said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in her dua, Oh Allah, I'm making a vow. I'm donating whatever in my stomach, whatever in my womb, to be for you alone, to serve your house, to be the servant of your house. Oh Allah, accept from me. Wallahi al-azim, if we learn this, listen, and practice it, our life will be changed. Because we do the action of worship with arrogance. With arrogance. As if we guaranteed the acceptance of Allah. As if we are doing favor to Allah Azza wa Jal by worshiping Him. We need to do and to remember what Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَمْنُن تَسْتَكْثِرْ وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. لَا تَمْنُن تَسْتَكْثِرْ. When you do something, don't say I did a lot. Don't praise yourself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, لَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. So it is very important to make maintenance to your iman. It is very important because Allah does not accept from somebody associating partners with Allah. Shirk will make your deeds worthless. Also, sincerity is a condition for the acceptance. And showing off will make your deeds worthless. Also, following the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam and making the actions of worship according to his teaching is a condition for the acceptance. And inventing in the deed and making innovation will make your deed worthless, will make your deed return back. Al-man, when you do the righteous action and keep mentioning what you did, praising yourself, Allah will not accept it. Allah will make the deeds worthless. Allah wants you to be humble. Allah wants you to do whatever you are able to do to the best of your ability and to say, Oh Allah, I did not do enough. Allah wants you to come out of the salah to say, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah, Astaghfirullah. Allah deserves better. Allah deserves more. Having said that, I want to conclude with hadith reported in Sahih Muslim, narrated by the mother of the believers, Aisha radiallahu anha. She said, she heard the Prophet Muhammad saying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يدخل الجنة أحدا عمله. لا يدخل الجنة أحدا عمله. So none of you will enter Jannah by his deeds. So Aisha said, even you, O Messenger of Allah, your deeds will not take you to Jannah? He said, even me. My deeds will never take me to Jannah. إلا أن يتغمدني الله برحمته. Except if Allah will grant me His mercy. So your deeds will never be equal to the price of Jannah, whatever you did. Even the deeds of the Prophet are not enough as price for Jannah. You are doing the deeds to prove your obedience and to purify your own soul. So when you are humble, when you are righteous and pious, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on you and He pays for you the price of Jannah. You will not be able to pay it. There is a hadith, and this hadith is reported in Mustadrak al-Imam al-Hakim. And al-Imam al-Hakim said the hadith is authentic. Even Sheikh al-Albani did not agree with him. Sheikh al-Albani said the hadith is da'if. But al-Imam al-Hakim in his book al-Mustadrak mentioned this hadith and he said the hadith is authentic. Narrated by Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu. He mentioned that a man in the past, when people used to live hundreds of years, lived 500 years worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like a monk on the top of a mountain. The hadith is saying that this person, Allah provided to him a well of water, especially for him to drink from. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted him a tree to eat fruit every day. Even the fruit that comes in a season, in one season in the year, Allah gives him this fruit every day. Worshiping Allah on the top of a mountain for 500 years until he passed away. The day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will tell this person, and this is something should be narrated by the Prophet, something about the unseen in the future. This person, will it will be said to him, enter al-Jannah by the mercy of Allah. And he will say, no. Oh Allah, I worshipped you 500 years. I want to enter al-Jannah by my deeds. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, put his deeds in a pan and put one of my favors upon him in the other pan. Put his sight. Put one eye. Then the eye was heavier than his deeds in 500 years. So Allah will say to the angels, take him to hell. He will cry and say, oh Allah, I go to Jannah by your mercy. I go to Jannah by your mercy. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to the angels, take him to Jannah by my mercy. وَلَا نِعْمَ الْعَبْدِ كُنْتِ. He used to be the best servant. Allah's praising him. He did good. But he cannot say that he paid one of Allah's favors. He cannot say that he paid the price of al-Jannah. The Prophet said, أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ غَالِيَةَ أَلَا إِنَّ سِلْعَةَ اللَّهِ الْجَنَّةَ. أقول قولي هذا وأسأل الله عز وجل أن يغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوب أجمعين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين. وهب المسيئين منا للمحسنين. اللهم تقبل عنا صالح أعمالنا. اللهم تقبل عنا صلاتنا. تقبل عنا إيماننا. تقبل عنا صيامنا. تقبل عنا زكاتنا. تقبل عنا حجنا. تقبل عنا عمرتنا. اللهم أصلح قلوبنا واشرح صدورنا واحفظ فروجنا. أصلحنا وأزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا صالحين مصلحين. اللهم اهدنا ويسر الهدى لنا واهدي أزواجنا وأولادنا واجعلنا هداة مهتدين. اللهم اغفر لنا واغفر لآبائنا واغفر لأمهاتنا ولعلمائنا ومشايخنا ولمن له فضل علينا يا سميع الدعاء يا عظيم الإحسان. اللهم إنا نسألك أن تجعل خير أعمالنا خواتيمها وخير أيامنا يوم لقائك. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في فلسطين. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في غزة. اللهم انصر عبادك المستضعفين في غزة. اللهم كن لهم ولا تكن عليهم. كن معهم ولا تكن ضدهم. انصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم. اللهم سدد رميهم واجبر كسرهم وتقبل شهداءهم وداوي جرحاهم. اللهم إنهم حفاة فاحملهم. اللهم إنهم عراة فاكسهم. اللهم إنهم جوعى فأطعمهم. اللهم إنهم عطشى فاسقهم. اللهم من أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بخير فوفقه إلى كل خير، ومن أرادنا والإسلام والمسلمين بشر فاجعل كيده في نحره، واجعل تدبيره تدميره، واجعل الدائرة عليه يا رب العالمين. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. قوموا إلى صلاتكم يرحمكم الله. أقم الصلاة.